Hey Moyles, good morning to you.
Morning, Ger. How you doing?
Well, we were just chatting there. We were speculating with no information, but that it felt to me like there was a few goodbyes going on. I thought that perhaps Cluxton was saying goodbye on his lap of honour. I mean, he's put a lot in. He's reached a height that no one else has ever reached. He's been the most influential Gaelic footballer of his generation and potentially any generation. Mm. So, you know, there are no more mountains for some of these guys.
No, it's probably difficult enough to kind of, I don't think it's necessarily, I think some of them would be able to do it. Like, I think Cluxton would be physically able to do it, right? There's no issue there. I think a number of them would be physically able to do it. It's just actually just the desire and the real desire inside and actually other stuff that's going on in your life.
Yeah.
You know, because it's a long season. You know, they're going all the way to the very, very end. They'll kick straight back into a bit of club stuff, you know, straight away. So it's a very, very long season, and it has been a long number of seasons then for a number of them. So, you know, you've got fellas obviously with jobs. You know, I know Cluxton is a teacher, but, you know, Paddy Andrews has a pretty, you know, stressful enough job, I would imagine. Keno Sullivan is the same. Philly is doing his own thing, but trying to build a business, which takes time.
Multiple
businesses. The profile helps, you know, and will continue to help. So that might be a figure in his head to go, well, actually, am I better off being inside the camp rather than outside the camp, you know, and as ex-Dublin footballer rather than still being Dublin footballer? Probably the same question for Bernard, really. But I think your motivation can't just be, I want to stay around and do all that slog just so I can enhance my career or my business or whatever it is, because then you're not really doing it for the right reasons. Now, I'm not saying that would be the overriding emotion, but it might still be in the back of your head. I think you'll see four or five of them saying that's it.
And there's a possibility that Jim Gavin goes as well, that, like, there's a, again, somebody who has an exterior life beyond football, which is very high profile, and no doubt there's pressure involved in that too. So suddenly things change. This whole notion of this is a forever thing that we're going to live through forever, that's not right.
No, and it does change. I think, like, if you were Gavin, would you go?
I mean, maybe. I would be tempted to.
So would I.
Like, so, what if you come back and you get six?
You come back and get seven?
I mean,
back and get eight.
So when,
you know, when's enough? And I don't mean that from a Dublin GAA standpoint. Like, I mean, you could easily do six, seven, eight. But I think for him,
they lost? Do you know?
Yeah, I felt this one, there was more pressure on him on this one than any other previous one, purely because of, never mind the opposition, obviously, and but, like, I mean, Mayo obviously ran them close in the past, but, you know, the history of Kerry, Dublin, all that different type of stuff. But I just think some of the decisions he and his team have made, as in management team, over the last 3 or 4 months, primarily, you know, Connolly, obviously bringing Bernard back in. You know, there was a fair amount of media speculation in the last 2 weeks about getting Bernard back in, and he got back in. Didn't see game time, and I kind of felt like, was that a tip of the hat? Was that pressure being brought to bear from outside influences? I don't know. Then you have the Connolly situation, and you're kind of going, how has that really sat with the panel? Like, when they're, I'm sure they're all saying, oh, that's no problem, but when they're really at home on their own and they're talking to their wives or their girlfriends or whatever, they're saying, like, you know what, I'm really pissed off that he's back in. I've done all the hard slog. He was going to go to America. Does it cause angst? And is it a sword that he may have potentially fallen on, you know, if it doesn't go right?
Yeah, my view on that was always that if Connolly is in the country and he's in Croke Park on All-Ireland final day and the camera pans to him in the crowd and they pick him out and he's not on the field and Dublin lose, then everybody's going to go, Jim didn't bend over backwards, Jim didn't do enough to try and win this thing. So, like, I always thought that he played that quite well, and I'm sure that if you were McManaman or Paddy Andrews or Bernard Brogan, you would have been like, hang on a second now, because that's my place. That's my place on the bench that he's taken.
Yes.
Whereas if you're one of the defenders, you're like, great, I get to go up against this guy and train and I get to, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so Jack McCarthy's saying that in the paper today, I was beaming when Connolly came back. It was great, you know.
Yeah.
Now he is saying this, like, the full emotional thing is happening. It's the day after he's match, in good form.
And yeah, like, yeah. You know, there's a lot of emotion.
He's the happiest man he's ever going to be.
There's a lot of endorphins flying around.
There is like multiple, like shot in the arm.
But what if the flip of that happens? So what if
they were
bet, you know, and the camera pans to Brogan sitting on the bench or Onogara sitting in the stand.
Yeah.
And they have a face on them like, you know, that would stop a clock. And they have Connolly on the pitch. And he's not, like, Connolly was okay when he came on.
It was a risk.
He did one or two good things, and he did three or four pretty ordinary things. You know, he got caught in possession, he kicked one or two wides, it's funny, when he came on, you can just see straight away, if you were to ask anyone who doesn't have anything about Gaelic football, what does this guy, he does things that no one else does on the pitch.
Yeah.
You know, even the balls he was given, you know, he hit this beautiful outside of the right ball that just went a bit too far. Do you remember across the pitch, it skidded on the grass and the Kerry guy got it. Like a little bit less, and that was an unbelievable pass.
Yeah.
I can't remember who came out to it. His ball into Kilkenny, whether it was on for O'Callaghan or not, is debatable. But still, he does things and he tries things, but actually that don't really fit in the makeup, of the team.
I would have said that, and then there was so much kick passing going on from Dublin straight out. There was a couple of times where they went the length of the pitch, catch kick, and like, holy shit, this is like, you know, they can do anything and everything. And so that was a bit of a wild card, I thought, for Kerry to suddenly go, what do we do here? How do we deal with that?
Yeah.
Look, I mean, we're sitting here now post event, and you would say that it worked out. I don't think it was the reason they won. You know, they didn't win because
no. But it could have been. It could have been potentially the reason they lost. And I'm just mean that in the sense of, and I know this is complete semantics here, but you're talking about potentially the impact it really had in the panel. You know, like, I mean, no one will really know. Maybe you'll hear some sort of, I doubt it, right? They've won. But you know the usual, right? You win, you're an absolute hero. You lose, all of a sudden everyone's pointing the finger and saying, like, I mean, you should never have brought him back in. There was this. There was always going to be plenty of that. I thought Dublin really did it really brilliantly over the last couple of weeks, and I have to say, you know, they were top notch yesterday. But I thought Kerry really will regret yesterday. Never mind the first day. I think some of the stuff they did, I thought was quite basic in their errors. I think in some of their matchups, in their use of the subs, in use of the panel actually, and some of the ideas that they had. You know, whether that first 10 minutes was preordained or not, I just thought it was absolutely handing the impetus to Dublin.
Yeah, and they spent the whole rest of the half getting back into the game and kind of being the better team for a long period of time in that first half. But the effort it takes out of you to get back from having coughed up a 5-point lead.
Like, I mean, I've played against Dublin before where they come out of the traps lively and you're always saying to yourself you're going to be five or six down, and then you start to dig into it and you're kind of the amount of effort, as you say, to get back 6-6 or 7-6 is unbelievable. The first 10 minutes, you can watch it. There's And it's not even that a lot of it, the first 7-8 minutes, this high ball idea into the full forward line, which was very, very straight.
It was lorried in as opposed to...
Yeah, and three of them came from dead balls. Three of them came. Moran had two, and Sean O'Shea had one. So there were balls that they had in their own possession, no pressure on the kick, and you're kind of going, just give it and go, just pass and move. But instead, they were lumped in, and actually on three occasions, like, I watched the video again last night, you have a 4-on-2, a 5-on-2, and a 4-on-2.
Yeah.
Without Cluxton.
Not great odds.
Not great odds. Like, you're kind of going, you know, okay, if we get one, great. But, like, I mean, Dublin have obviously gone, okay, they're going to do this. So you have to quickly change. Now, after about 7, 8, 9 minutes, you see they actually do change. They start putting the ball through the hands. And then all of a sudden they start getting joy.
Yeah.
But at that stage, it's 5-1. You know, and you're kind of going, lads, we've already created a mountain here for ourselves. Now, they climbed it brilliantly. But, you know, when you've guys like that inside, and you would have thought Dublin are definitely going to be afraid of the threat in there. So they're going to deploy a man back. And we need to actually, even if we do it once, we then change. Now, the tactic could have been, we're going to do this for a certain period of time, lead Dublin into this false sense that we're going to just continue to do this, and then actually play, you know, balls inside, lower balls, and come out in front, grab them, because that'll make the defenders take a step back rather than a step forward. I don't know, but it didn't work.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, sorry, that I hadn't thought about that. That it was like you establish this, you establish this, you establish this. But actually, the real thing you're trying to do is play them, make sure the defenders play from behind instead of in front.
It could have been because, like, I mean, so as a defender, when you start seeing those balls, you kind of go, "Well, I'm not going to take that step in front. I'm actually going to play him from slightly behind." And then what you do is, as soon as you see the man kind of nearly shaping up to kick it, you're already thinking about getting back to base.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, he just makes a 20-yard forward run, and he just gets a handy ball out in front, which they did start to find pockets of space. But actually, even the score, like, remember Geeney's score, he got, Obioglig made a bit of a run, he got fouled, he went down and he flicked it across, Geeney hit it with his left foot. Oh, yeah. Could have been a bit of a goal.
Yeah, it was definitely
goal chance.
Yeah.
That was just a lot of patience. They were just finding gaps in the Dublin defence, and the Dublin defence did very, very well. Like, they were a very tight unit. I just, there was a couple of those. Like, I mean, if you're going to do that again, then why don't you start Tommy Walsh?
I mean, look, let's come back to these Tommy Walsh later on, because there's loads of points have been raised there that we should dig into, and we will get into this in proper detail in a couple of minutes.
And Philly all out in champions again. How have the celebrations been over the last 12, 14, 16 hours?
It kind of feels similar to the last couple of years, but it's obviously nice having it on a Saturday, winning the All-Ireland on a Saturday and having a Sunday. Getting down to see the kids in the hospitals is really important to us. And, you know, giving them a bit of happiness and the smile on their face is very important.
Your own role in the match yesterday, a bit different than previous years when maybe you would have started. How did you find that? I know you said after the game yesterday that you wished that the game went on longer so you could have played longer.
Definitely, yeah. Like, I missed the Mayo game and I missed the Kerry, the first game. So, you know, going in at that time of the game where it was in the melting pot is quite tough. And marking a guy like Walsh, who's played a good bit. So, yeah, no, it was intense. It was exactly the way you want it. And as I said, I'd love to play a little bit longer, but we got over the line at the end.
Is the winning feeling at the end any different to each final that you've won in the last 5-6 years?
Yeah, definitely. As you get older in your career, definitely it is. You know, you don't know when the last one's going to be. So it's not that it's 4 or 5 in a row or whatever it is. It's just that you've won an All-Ireland and you've got over the line.
Philly, congrats, well done.
Thanks, Amy.
It's Philly McMahon speaking with Jamie Moore yesterday. Just on that, Saturday All-Ireland, like, can we not just get somebody to, you can put a motion to Congress now, surely. Come on, yeah, stick a motion in there. Saturday All-Ireland, and we can be 3 o'clock throw-ins, who cares? Like, the Sunday game was a Sunday game because farmers wouldn't be able to take the day off working, right, back in the day. I mean, yeah. Like...
And plenty of people worked on Saturday.
Yeah, and it turns out loads of people still work on Saturdays, right?
Yeah.
Like, but, I mean, come on. It was brilliant, having an extra day.
Yeah, no, it is. It is. I think the players will say, absolutely. The players will be all over it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it was. You were just saying there about the different feel. Looking at the pictures, it just looked absolutely... Like, I mean, what a beautiful day.
It was sensational,
It was absolutely perfect for football.
It was September as well.
Yeah.
It's like... I don't know, it's September, around the 16th.
It was just,
it's supposed to be.
We're going to get into the nitty-gritty of it, but some of the scoring, some of the movement, the hits, like, I mean, they were, the intensity of the play, like, I mean, the conditioning of both teams is absolutely phenomenal. You know, like, I mean, even Merchant's goal, you could see him coming out and he's blown. Like, I mean, the excitement. And I watched him, you wouldn't have seen this, but in the national anthem before, the camera pans him and he's the eyes closed and he's taking some really big, deep breaths. That was a big day for a young lad like that.
He is, yeah, you know? You forget.
I thought he was very, very good.
He was great.
Really good.
Yeah, he's not an archetypal defender, so he got taken on a couple of times. Mm. And I think the Gainey point you were talking about earlier on comes from somebody just beating him.
Yeah.
Maybe it was Ugly. But he's not in the team to do that. He's in the team to do loads of different things. And for the pace.
Yes.
For the recovery pace.
Yeah.
And for picking up those, like, he was go-to for quite a lot of kickouts, or certainly the next pass off the short kickout loads of times.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
He had an excellent game. I don't know who got man of the match officially.
I don't know. I think people were talking about
Kilkenny. Kilkenny got the RT one, yeah.
Yeah, Kilkenny.
You can't argue with that too much.
Yeah. I thought he was good. You know, he made an unbelievable block.
I think the block was the Hollywood. That was
the Hollywood block. That was kind of like a cherry on top.
Man of the match. Thanks very much.
Yeah. Obioglig was following him. I'm like, of all the Kerry defenders, I think Obioglig is probably one of the weakest, right? So I'm not saying he had an easy day, right? But I think of all of the guys, you'd say, okay, this is a fella I'm happy enough to probably take on. I think so. He probably showed up a little bit better than say Mannion did, or even Conde. But I thought O'Callaghan had an unbelievable game. There was a threat every time he got the ball. He's marking their best defenders marking him.
Yeah, and I think he had that same threat in the first game. Certainly, you could feel at the game that every time he got the ball, he was on the verge of doing something. Yeah. It just didn't break for him. And the three early points certainly gave everybody, okay, right, let's all just make sure that this isn't going to happen again to us.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
You were saying earlier on that you thought Kerry were going to have significant regrets and about the basic errors in strategy, tactics, matchups. If we were to rank the errors and the stuff that's going to give them the sleepless nights, what's it going to be?
Maybe selection, first of all. You know, I think where they've been a bit too cute. Like, I, we were talking last week of, you know, whether you would start Tommy Walsh. And I think if you're going to, the premise of starting him is based around, obviously, what style of play you're going to adopt for the game. And if you're going to adopt for the first 10 minutes, we're going to put in long ball, high ball into a two-man full forward line, well, then you're going to say, well, I'll tell you who I want in there. Mm. I want a guy in there who Dublin are going to be worried about, because he is physically a presence in there. And you can then have even three in there. You can have Geaney and Clifford around him.
Yeah.
But if we're going to, I always felt Kerry needed to be, they couldn't be chasing that game for the first 10, 15, 20 minutes. It was going to be too much of a mountain to climb after the last day. They needed to actually get out of the traps early and put Dublin under pressure and really start with Dublin to ask the questions. Once Dublin got the goal and once they got it, they looked pretty much in control to me. They were able to always tag on a score. And even though Kerry got back to the 10-all, there was some magnificent scores in that. You always felt a little bit that they were striving, they were putting a bit more effort into it to get to that level rather than Dublin were. You know, that was the sense I got. So I think he, above all, would have. I don't think the O'Connor thing really worked out for them. You know, I pretty much speculated with you that I thought Gavin White wouldn't start. He didn't. I don't know if he really added a whole pile when he came in. You know, if you're looking for legs, that's all fine, you know, but I think the impact players needed to be on the field. You're looking for those guys who are really going to make an impact from start. Then if you want to bring legs on at 45, 50 minutes, you're 2 or 3 points ahead, bring the legs on and say, right, you pick up him, just run with him, make sure you knock him, you know, make sure he doesn't do anything spectacular, keep with him, and we kind of, what we have, we hold, and we counter-attack then. We soak up a bit of pressure and counter-attack because we still have two of the most dangerous forwards in the country. And Geaney and Clifford were living off scraps for a lot of that second half.
But played well, and we're playing well. Geaney really had a great game.
Savage game.
I
think he was man of the match for Kerry.
And I think I'm delighted for him because he didn't get any credit after the miss and the penalty miss the last day, even though he did play quite well. But just on the point about starting Tommy Walsh, Dublin have to react to that somehow. And now, maybe they always had it in their head that Philly McMahon was going to mark him. But who knows? If you start Tommy Walsh, like 15 minutes before throw-in or whatever time you have to announce your team, do Dublin then have to make that change before as well? Are they?
Potentially.
And so suddenly they're thinking twice, going, that's not actually what we wanted to do.
Yeah, exactly. And it's kind of, it's already, you know, to a certain degree, they're dancing to your tune. You know, so it's already a little bit of a psychological win for you. I thought he did really well when he came in.
He won every ball.
He won every ball. He won it out in front. Yeah. He did what he needed to do. And you see, he gives you that as well, Jerry. Well, we were talking about that first 10 minutes of you put in ball after ball. I think it was at least five or six balls that went in long, right? So as I say, the defender takes a step back. Now, if you've Tommy Walsh in there and one or two, then you just give him the ball out in front and he wins it out in front and he has runners.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a bit more open. There's a bit more pace on the run. There's a bit more kind of, you know, fellas being all over the place. I certainly would. I think he should have started. And, you know, honestly, I think probably whatever way you can engineer it, I thought they needed to have all of their firepower on. Whether you don't start Spillane or not, it would have been between him or Tommy. I think you needed to just a bit more firepower up front. You definitely needed more firepower up front. I think then they're central, their core, they're six. I thought they just got pulled out of there way too much. So I think they should have said, right, what we're going to do is we're going to deploy someone back there, whether that was Spillane or Jack Barry. But they needed someone just to sit in that hole in front of O'Callaghan. Because O'Callaghan, essentially, if you watch, he loves to get the ball really at the top of the D. And then he just turns at you in an instant and he's going right down the gun at you. Mannion likes to get it more out to the side where he'll be able to step and he's turned onto his left foot and then he can swing it over with his left foot. He loves to get that ball where he's coming down the right side, steps inside you. Whereas O'Callaghan is, give it into me here, high, low, dirty, it doesn't make a difference, and I'll go right at you. Now, you need a man there who has the ability to double up as soon as he gets that. You may not stop the pass, but you can certainly get there and help your cornerback or your fullback, and they didn't have that really.
Yeah, and that wasn't new news to them either. Was it because O'Callaghan didn't perform on the scoreboards that they thought that wasn't going to happen again? So therefore, look, that's grand. We had those matchups right from the first day.
Maybe there was a little bit of that. I think Dublin learnt. Like I thought, you know, I heard Owen and yourself were chatting about deploying Keane O'Sullivan and stuff like that. But Dublin, I was saying, no, O'Sullivan potentially with his injuries and stuff like that, I didn't think it would happen. But they learned from the first day in the sense of they went, okay, you know what? We're not even going to be brave about this and try and think we're going to concede the fact that they have some serious forwards and we're just going to put an extra man in there.
And it worked.
Yeah.
In that first 10 minutes, it worked perfectly. It was like, as you said, they were overloading and they always at least had one and sometimes two men extra free. Why would
what people miss on that as well, though, is, and this is what Dublin do so well, when they won those five or six balls, watch the exit, how quick the exit comes. Because they actually have guys, Davey Byrne just took off, McCaffrey took off a few times, and all of a sudden they're coming running at you in threes and fours, and you're going, who do we pick up?
Yeah.
So it's not like you've tagged a guy and he goes in a run and you're able to stop his run. It's now fellas coming at full speed, changing angles, much more difficult to stop.
The kickouts, if you were to go back and just kind of watch the two videos side by side from the two games, they were completely different. There was almost no contested balls around midfield from both sides. And neither side put up a high press for the majority of the game.
Both sides won every single one of their kickouts in the first half. I don't think that has happened in a game all championship.
Why was that? Why were they just deciding, okay, we're going
to... Well, first of all, you obviously had Dublin, who had decided to drop back a man, right, slightly. So he was a bit more removed. But I think they just said, you know what, let's have them there. We have a man back here, we look after it. Because you can't... It's very difficult to play that high press and also have a man back.
Okay.
You're really...
One or the other.
Yeah, you can't. Because what happens with the high press is if they get out over it, you're completely exposed.
Yeah.
So they said, we don't want to be that. So we'll actually just give them the kick out here and we'll take it on from, you know, 45, 50 metres out from their own goal, and we'll slow it down. And that's essentially what they did. Now, they still made it difficult enough, but to be fair, Ryan had a very good game in goals for Kerry.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a guy who's probably, you know, new on the scene. I thought he was really, really good. I thought he was very, very good with his kickouts. You know, there was a couple of times there where he just got them out into areas down the middle, especially to Paul Murphy, you know, where there was a lot of bodies around and he just got a little perfect little chipped kickout. But no, I think both teams said, well, we've shown our hand on that, so we'll revert back and we'll just try something different.
Yeah.
I think Spillane as well was meant to, if you watch Spillane was meant to, I think, be back in that middle role. A lot of the scores where you see where that middle has been exposed, he's kind of chasing back. He wasn't there exactly, you know, and I'd say when they looked back at it, they went, maybe he wasn't the man for that, because it's quite a different role for him. I don't think that's not his thing.
I thought as well, Paul Murphy's injury was something that Kerry couldn't afford, whereas Dublin could just about afford Jack McCaffrey's. Like, they, you know, Howard ends up going back and they're able to absorb it in a way that it's not critical, but Kerry didn't have anybody to drive forward at that point in the game when they needed him.
But I watched it again last night. I think they took 8 minutes,
minutes
to get him off. You know, and I'm kind of going, that's 7-8 minutes of a critical period. And you remember, a ball comes down and he was kind of acting as the spare man for a while, because I was trying to watch where he was involved, and he doesn't get on the ball at all in that period, right? He doesn't present himself at all. And then a ball comes down, a kind of a scuttery ball comes down the middle, and he goes across and he pulls on it. If you remember, he slides, kind of pulls on it, and then he goes down on the leg. So that was obviously the final part of the hamstring. But he had definitely done it, because you can see him on the ground on the TV, and he's saying to whoever comes over, there's something wrong. So I'm kind of going, get him off straight away. And they actually make two other substitutions before they substitute him.
Right.
They substitute, they bring on Gavin White, and they bring on Sherlock. So now you've taken off two other guys, and now you have to take off him. You know, and you're kind of going, okay, now you've, you know, even from a substitute type of, you know, you're sitting there and you're going, I have my guys who I need to come in. You probably would have brought Sherlock in for him, you know, and then kept, who did Sherlock come in for? I think Sherlock may have come in for Mbeugleich.
Right.
But you would have said, because now you've essentially used three backs, you know, when really you didn't want to. You could have only used two.
Yeah, and
it's a small thing, but it matters.
Well, it's, at that stage, it feels like they could get that back. They could still get into the game, and they don't get into the game, and it's those little, it's an accumulation of all those decisions, really, as opposed to one individual thing.
Yeah.